The French are glad to die for love. They delight in fighting duels. But I prefer a man who lives and gives expensive jewels. A kiss on the hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend.
Marilyn Monroe is the greatest legend in Hollywood history.
Isn't it delicious?
All the guys had an eye for Marilyn, and she liked the guys.
She did behave badly. She was unprofessional at times. She could be incredibly difficult.
Cut it.
What we saw with Marilyn Monroe was the tragedy and the vulnerability.
Wait a minute.
She was a carefully crafted show business creation, an alluring blend of sex and sensitivity. But more than three decades after her untimely death, Marilyn Monroe has come to represent more than just a Hollywood actress. She has become an icon, an immortal symbol of glamour and sensuality. Hers is the legend of a great star who burned brightly, but all too briefly.
She used to say, I don't want to be rich, I just want to be loved. She represented those two strongest of human emotions, which are hope and fear.
Hollywood, California, the dream factory of the world, a place where real life and fantasy often converge and sometimes collide. It was here on June 1st, 1926, that Norma Jean Baker was born. Her mother, Gladys, had yearned for a job in show business, lured by the promise of jazz age excitement and easy prosperity. What she got was a 9-to-5 job splicing film for a local movie company, a series of lovers, and an unexpected pregnancy. Listing the name of a fictitious father on Norma Jean's birth certificate, Gladys had every intention of raising the child herself. But the social and economic pressures of single parenting were too great for Gladys. Emotionally fragile and financially unstable, she was often forced to place her daughter into state custody and a succession of foster homes. While in the care of couples who took her in to profit from government welfare assistance, the little girl felt isolated and insecure, and easy prey to the horrors of emotional and even sexual abuse.
When she was little and she was a very neglected child, she literally thought she was invisible. She thought she couldn't be seen, because children who are not focused on enough do come to believe they're invisible.
In 1935, after a brief attempt to care for Norma Jean herself, Gladys suffered a severe mental breakdown. She had threatened a close friend with a knife, and she was committed to a state psychiatric institution. At the age of 9, Norma Jean was again placed in foster care. Her adolescence was spent in the rural farmland communities of the San Fernando Valley, just north of Los Angeles. It was here that she dreamed of Hollywood stardom. Hiding in the shadows of the silver screen, she could escape into a world where men like Clark Gable embodied strength and independence, and women like Jean Harlow used glamour and sex to obtain power and popularity. Emotionally alone, Norma Jean craved attention, especially the kind she saw being lavished on her screen idols. Fortunately, she wouldn't have to wait very long.
When she became a teenager and she started to develop breasts and hips and this, you know, amazing physical self, boys noticed her. She became visible for the first time.
By the age of 15, Norma Jean had found relative stability in the well-kept home of Grace McKee. But that would not last long.
Marilyn was married off because her foster parents and her relatives didn't want the burden of, in 1942, wartime, of caring for a teenager and being responsible for her. So the minute she turned marriageable legal age, according to the state of California. They married her off to a perfectly affable, decent young man.
I met Norma Jean in 1941. Norma Jean was going to Van Nuys High School. My first impression was that she was a beautiful young girl. And of course, she was only 15 at the time. But I recognized the fact that she was shy. And when she talked in a soft voice. And but she had beautiful eyes. When we decided to get married, she was going to be left by Doc and Grace. They were going back to Virginia. Adele was sending him back there. And Grace asked my mother if I would marry her, if I wanted to marry her. And I thought, you know, she's pretty young, but she's going to be in an orphanage or another foster home. So I agreed to it. And she became 16 on June 1st, and we were married the 19th. So she'd only been 16 a short time. In fact, I just turned 21 in April. So I was a whippersnapper too. It was great. She was a wonderful wife. She was a good cook. She was an immaculate housekeeper. And she enjoyed being married.
Marriage offered Norma Jean the chance to play housewife and the opportunity to develop a real family of her own. It also encouraged her to search for the father who had abandoned her and her mother so many years earlier, a man she only knew by name.
Sandy Gifford was her father, and he eventually became a producer and director. And she got on the phone, she looked up his number, and she called him. And he wouldn't recognize her. He said, no, I don't know who you are. See my attorney, this kind of stuff. And she didn't want anything from him. She was real sad, and she sat down, and I sat down next to her, and I gave her a lot of TLC for about an hour, and she come out of it all right. So, but he missed a good chance.
As America entered the Second World War, Norma Jean's new domestic life would prove to be short-lived.
Well, time came, I had to ship out, and she always wanted me to let her have a baby. And she said, in case something happens to you, I'll have a piece of you. I said, you're too young to be having children. And if anything did happen to me, you would have a real anchor on your neck, and it wouldn't be good for you.
Like so many wives of GIs stationed overseas, Norma Jean joined the war effort at a local defense plant where she made parachutes. Although she missed her husband, she enjoyed working and grew used to living alone. But the attractive brunette would not be alone for long. Approached by an Army photographer looking for pretty girls to help boost troop morale, she agreed to pose for a series of cheesecake pictures. And soon, Norma Jean Doherty would be known as Miss Flamethrower. Flattered by the attention and feeling one step closer to her dreams of stardom, she accepted an offer with the Blue Book Modeling Agency. Within weeks, she was adorning the covers of countless national and international publications.
I was in Buenos Aires, and here's a magazine, I forget which one it was, her picture's on the cover. And I'm telling these guys, this is my wife. And they said, sure it is. Yeah, you betcha.
At 20, Norma Jean realized she had the means to control her own destiny. But the spotlight on her career only served to expose the flaws in her marriage.
I said to her one day, I said, you know, when I get home and I'm out of the service, you're going to have to make a choice. You're going to be Mrs. Doherty, or you're going to be an actress. Well, I was on the Yangtze River when the mail come aboard, and it was a Dear John. I wouldn't sign the papers until I got home. And at that time, she couldn't divorce me. So I came home, and she was insistent that she was going to get a divorce. So I said, okay. When I signed the papers, she said, I've got a new name. I said, what is it? She says, Marilyn Monroe. And I said, well, geez, where'd they come from? Well, she says, my mother's maiden name was Monroe, and my grandmother's middle name was Marilyn. And I give her a kiss, and I said goodbye, and that's the last kiss I saw her with. She still insisted we could live together. And I said, no.
On October 2nd, 1946, in the sterile court chambers of Reno, Nevada, the four-year marriage of Norma Jean and James Doherty ended. What began was America's love affair with Marilyn Monroe. In 1947, after gracing the covers of literally hundreds of magazines, Marilyn convinced the Blue Book Modeling Agency to arrange a screen test for her at 20th Century Fox. When studio chief Daryl F. Zanuck saw the footage, he offered the young model a one-year contract at $125 a week. Like all young actresses with great ambition and little experience, Marilyn was hopeful that this break would lead to stardom. Unfortunately, it led to little more than a brief screen appearance in Scudahoo, Scudahay.
June Haver, the star, and Natalie Wood, who was then a child, are standing outside of a church having conversation. Parishioners are coming out the door behind them. One of the parishioners is a girl with long blonde hair wearing a blue pinafore and a white blouse. She says hello to June Haver. June Haver turns, looks at her and greets her back. That's Marilyn Monroe in her film debut.
As he needs it.
Oh, hush up and go wait in the car. Hi, Red.
Well, hi, Betty.
But Marilyn would do anything to stay in front of the cameras. She submitted to countless hours of singing and dancing lessons. She even underwent cosmetic surgery to slim the tip of her nose. Nevertheless, when her 12-month contract with the studio was up, Marilyn was out. Undaunted, she took her screen test to Columbia Pictures and secured a 6-month offer of employment. Her first assignment was a top role in a low-budget musical.
Anyone can see I love you. Anyone can see I care.
You'll be sure to send this right away, won't you?
Wouldn't you rather deliver it in person?
Miss Martin.
Yes.
Every baby needs a dad, dad, daddy to keep her worry-free. Every baby needs a dad, dad, daddy, but where's the one for me?
But though Ladies of the Chorus was a modest success and Marilyn's screen chemistry was abundantly apparent, the film failed to provide the break that she was hoping for. And despite the personal attention of Columbia boss Harry Cohn, Marilyn's contract was not renewed. By now, it seemed the blonde starlet's film career would be limited to occasional TV commercials.
This is the first car I ever owned. I call her Cynthia. She's going to have the best care a car ever had. Put Royal Triton in Cynthia's little tummy.
Right, lady.
Cynthia will just love that Royal Triton.
By 1949, with little hope for a movie career and with money in short supply, Marilyn was once again available for anyone with a compliment and a camera.
Marilyn Monroe was on her way to an audition, and she got into a traffic accident. So she's pulled over at the side of the road on a street in L.A., wanting desperately to get to the audition. And another car pulls over, and it turns out it's a photographer named Tom Kelly. He starts a conversation with her, and pretty quickly gives her $5 to grab a cab to the audition. A couple of years later, he was the millionth photographer to ask her to pose nude, and she had clearly remembered that side of the road $5 bill that got her to her audition, and she said yes, she would, if his wife could be present.
As far as Marilyn was concerned, the nude calendar session was just another way of paying the rent. Besides, modeling came easily to her, as easily as attracting men. One such man was an influential William Morris agent named Johnny Hyde. Although he was 30 years her senior, Hyde was smitten with his 23-year-old client. He was equally devoted to promoting her career. But though Marilyn refused his impulsive offers of marriage, she couldn't refuse the role that he got her in John Huston's gritty 1950 urban crime drama, The Asphalt Jungle.
I'll never forget the day she tested for The Asphalt Jungle. Now, Marilyn Monroe was very insecure, as we all know. And she came up to the testing, and I met her at the steps of the Thalberg building. Now, she had the most beautiful figure in the world. She had a size 42-inch bust. She stuffed it with cotton. And, you know, she looked like a chiffonier with the top drawer pulled out. And I said, Marilyn, for God's sake, you look grotesque. And so the next day I saw John Huston. I said, what'd you do with Marilyn Monroe's falsies? He says, I reached in, took them out, and says, Marilyn, you have the part.
Only once in a decade does the screen come up with such absorbing characters. Sterling Hayden as Dix Handley, a hooligan with a twisted dream. Gene Hagen as Doll, the dime a dance dame who wanted to share that shabby dream. Marilyn Monroe as Angela, the easy living green eyed blonde.
Haven't you bothered me enough, you big banana head? Just try breaking my door, and Mr. Emmerich will throw you out of the house.
Though the part was small, it proved that Marilyn's acting range might be broader than her earlier appearances suggested. And even if she had to continue playing dumb blondes in featured roles, Marilyn and Johnny were determined that she would be the best. Back at Fox, she proved it in All About Eve.
You see that man? That's Max Fabian, the producer. Now go and do yourself some good.
Why do they always look like unhappy rabbits?
Because that's what they are. Go and make him happy.
Featured with a galaxy of top stars, Marilyn managed to shine.
A waiter.
And that isn't a waiter, my dear. That's a butler.
Well, I can't yell, oh, butler, can I? Maybe somebody's name is butler.
You have a point. An idiotic one, but a point.
I don't want to make trouble. All I want is a drink.
Leave it to me. I'll get you one.
Thank you, Mr. Fabian.
Well done. I can see your career rising in the east like the sun.
And though the part came dangerously close to self-parody, it earned her glowing notices. Among those who noticed was 20th Century Fox chairman Joseph Schenck. With Hyde's blessing, Marilyn cultivated a close personal relationship with Schenck, one that resulted in an offer of a second contract with 20th Century Fox, this time with a commitment for 7 years, starting at $500 per week. Now cast in a series of lightweight and often forgettable films, Marilyn continued to play the shapely and usually light-headed blonde.
Say, remember the night I drove you to the airport?
Uh-huh.
Well, on the way back to Paris, I hit a hay wagon. You never saw such a mess. It took me days to get the straw out of my hair. None of the girls would believe me when I told them how it happened.
Funny, but every time I want to talk business, you're always too busy.
But it's true, Mr. McKinley. You know, as a rule, I never mix business and pleasure. Huey, is it true that Victor McFarlane's coming here to the hotel? I was in the beauty parlor when they said...
He's due in any moment. Would you like to meet him?
Who wouldn't want to meet a man worth millions who isn't even bald? I was reading all about him in Time magazine. They said he's the most eligible bachelor in the United States.
And you'd like to talk him out of it?
Uh-huh.
Okay, Joyce, I'll fix it.
Honey, you're not even human. You're just a living doll.
Desperate to avoid the pitfalls of typecasting, Marilyn pleaded for bigger and more challenging roles. Finally, in 1952, she got one. Agreeing to be loaned out to RKO for an adaptation of Clifford Odette's play Clash by Night, she garnered some of the best reviews of her career. But as the film was appearing in movie houses, Marilyn was appearing in gas stations all over the country. The John Baumgarth Calendar Company had managed to purchase the rights for Marilyn's nude photographs. Now, everyone knew Marilyn Monroe, and not everyone approved.
You know, the thing about the calendar is that it would have destroyed anyone's career. We're talking about the mores of 1952, when the world found out that this naked woman was Marilyn Monroe, the actress.
Adding fuel to the fire was the inclusion of the now infamous photo in the very first issue of Playboy magazine, published the next year.
She was the absolute perfect choice. She became popular the same year that the magazine began. And I don't think there's any question but what the success and the popularity of Marilyn Monroe is directly related to her more obvious sexuality and the very fact that she did pose nude for a calendar and then admit it and make jokes about it. Say that she had nothing on but the radio.
She gave a forthright, honest answer. People could relate to it. If anything, it finally glorified her.
By facing the scandal head-on, Marilyn Monroe dealt a devastating blow to the conservative standards of 1950s America. She now represented a refreshing reinterpretation of the modern woman, one who was not willing to equate sex with sin. It was a message post-war America was waiting to hear. And in one swift move, Marilyn Monroe went from being a starlet to being a star.
Good afternoon, my dear. Aren't you a little lonely, window shopping all by yourself? Wouldn't you prefer to come and play in my backyard?
Sure, I don't mind if you buy me a drink. How's the cousin Fanny?
In 1952, Fox cast their newest asset in a series of films. Films that exploited her most obvious charms.
There's your mommy.
But while Marilyn's allure was usually played for laughs, Don't Bother to Knock featured Monroe as a disturbed babysitter and offered the actress her most dramatic and challenging role to date.
Do you have a doll at home?
Yes, Josephine.
What if it cried and pestered and spied on you? You'd want to get rid of it, wouldn't you? You'd have to.
The performance is one of such intensity and such pathos. An array of feelings cross her face. The tears are natural. The look of forlorn inner disarray that characterizes that performance. Anyone who doubts that Marilyn Monroe had a serious talent should look. Here she is at the age of 25, and she's anything but merely a common, cheap little bimbo.
A month ago, I came here on a bus from Oregon. At night on the highway, we'd pass those big trucks with those little lights all over them, like Christmas trees.
But her predominantly male audiences preferred to see their Marilyn in less challenging comedic roles.
Hi. I'm so glad I found you.
No, I found you. Pick a finger.
Dr. Fulton.
Oh, you know that one?
Yes.
Oh, what a pity.
In Monkey Business.
How dare you?
She appeared alongside Ginger Rogers and Cary Grant.
Don't you do that. Oh, you too. Good morning, Dr. Fulton.
Good morning. Aren't you here early?
Oh, yes. Mr. Oxley's been complaining about my punctuation, so I'm careful to get here before 9.
For this film, Marilyn dyed her hair Jean Harlow's trademark platinum color and completed her metamorphosis into Hollywood's hottest sex symbol.
Find someone to type this.
Oh, Mr. Oxley, can't I try again?
No, it's very important. Better find someone to type it for you.
Yes, sir.
Anybody can type.
The dreams that had sustained her were now coming true. Marilyn Monroe was on the fast track to fame, and she was relishing the ride. In 1952, she was introduced to one of her biggest fans and one of America's biggest baseball heroes, Jolden Joe DiMaggio.
The late Vince Edwards, he said, Joe DiMaggio is so depressed, you know, he just got divorced. He says, we ought to fix him up with someone. And I said, I know a wonderful girl. And I mentioned Marilyn. Next night, she had a date with Joe DiMaggio and told me what a wonderful guy Joe DiMaggio was. I told her who he was. She did not know he was one of the greatest baseball stars of all time. Hell, she didn't even know what a baseball looked like, you know. And I told her the next day who he was. She says, well, we didn't talk baseball.
In stark contrast to most of the other men in her life, DiMaggio was quiet, conservative, family-oriented. He was also not in show business. Sparks flew, and the couple's courtship made headlines all over the world. For the press, it wasn't just love. It was the merger of two American institutions. Adding steam to the romance was the heat generated by Monroe's next film. Shot on location, Niagara cast Marilyn as a woman whose lustful indiscretions lead to murder.
Take me in your arms.
She sang of love just as she lived for love. Like a Lorelei, flaunting her charms as she lured men on and on to their eternal destruction.
You're getting all dressed up to go out and buy tickets.
I'm meeting somebody. Just anybody handy, as long as he's a man. How about the ticket seller himself? I could grab him on my way out. Or one of the kids with a phonograph. Anybody suits me. Take your pick.
Co-starring Joseph Cotten, Niagara proved that Monroe could now carry a big-budget dramatic film.
You've been very kind, but thanks. I'd rather walk.
And after making the longest on-screen walk in cinema history, it was clear she could offer the famous Falls some serious scenic competition. For the release of the film, Fox again launched a massive publicity campaign. If there was anyone around who had not heard of Marilyn Monroe, it wouldn't be that way for long.
Fabulous face. That's no exaggeration, that's my Marilyn.
Marilyn Monroe was really just starting to happen at that time. And we thought a great idea would be to have another Hollywood party. My band was playing at the Hollywood Palladium. So we had somebody write a song called Marilyn. We had about 500 press there from all over the world, along with a lot of the folks from Capitol Records and a few celebrities. Mickey Rooney was there and had to get in and some of the action playing the drums. And it was a fascinating kind of a party.
I'll be marrying, carrying Marilyn through my door.
For when those wedding bells chime, my Marilyn will be mine.
It's a tiara.
You do wear it on your head. I just love finding new places to wear diamonds.
As Lorelei Lee in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Marilyn stood out in a role that showcased her considerable charm and powerful screen presence.
Mr. Esmond.
Is it the right size?
Oh, they can never be too big. Do you think that's too small, Dorothy?
Looks like it ought to have a highball around it.
I mean, does it fit your finger?
Oh, yes, it fits perfect. Daddy, I bet you made me the happiest girl in the world.
I don't know what you do, honey, unless you use Novocaine in your lipstick.
We're just two little girls from Little Rock. But the gentlemen friends who used to call, they never did seem to mind at all. They came to the wrong side of the tracks.
Gentlemen Prefer Blondes was lavishly produced in Technicolor and co-starred the ravishing Jane Russell. The film offered just the kind of glittering setting that Monroe needed in order to sparkle.
A kiss on the hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend. A kiss may be grand, but it won't pay the rental on your humble flat or help you at the automat. Men grow cold as girls grow old, and we all lose our charms in the end. Square cut or pear shape, these rocks don't lose their shape. Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
The film was one of the year's smash hits.
Tiffany's.
Gentlemen Prefer Blondes was a delight from start to finish. She was not only lovely, she was terribly, terribly funny.
Gee, Peggy, a girl like I almost never gets to meet really interesting men. Sometimes my brain gets real starved.
Poor little thing.
It's a terrible thing to be lonesome. especially in the middle of a crowd. Do you know what I mean?
You'll never be lonesome again. Now you leave it to Piggy.
You're Mr. Franklin, aren't you? Yes. Are you enjoying your trip?
Oh.
How many times have you crossed?
This is my,
third... Don't you feel alone out on a big ocean?
Well, I
just adore conversation, don't you?
Monroe and Jane Russell arrived to make their imprints in the famous concrete of Grauman's Chinese Theater in Hollywood. Filmdom's first blonde and first brunette, Marilyn and Jane won their chance to join Filmdom's immortals by their work in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes.
For now, all the dreams and desires of Marilyn's life were fulfilled, the heartbreak of the past forgotten. There could be no moments more precious than these, or more fleeting. In the wake of Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Marilyn was, at last, receiving the attention she craved from her fans.
This is your television premiere, isn't it, Mario?
That's right. It feels almost like making pictures.
Ah, yeah. Listen, I want to tell you something. Up to this time, television has been a medium, but now I say it's well done.
In the conservative 1950s, she had struck a responsive nerve. Unfortunately, there were plenty of jealous Hollywood contemporaries who were anxious to strike back.
Marilyn never wore underwear. And she had this slinky dress on, and she received this photoplay award. The next day, Joan Crawford gave a story to a columnist saying that Marilyn Monroe was undignified.
I want to thank the editors of Photoplay magazine and all of the public. I thank you very much.
She put a twist on sexiness. It was not something wicked and shameful and shocking and dirty and embarrassing. It was something which was terribly funny, and Marilyn enjoyed it.
I hate a careless man.
In retrospect, although the 50s is clearly a time of very real political repression and social and sexual repression, you can see those early signs of changing values, and Monroe was clearly part of that.
At 26, Marilyn Monroe was the biggest star in the world. Her actions were detailed in newspapers. Her every word became grist for Hollywood's giant rumor mill. For once, the public's love for Marilyn seemed to match Marilyn's need for love. In 1953, she was teamed with Lauren Bacall and Betty Grable in the first widescreen comedy, How to Marry a Millionaire.
Is
he kidding?
Not at all. It's an old custom of the East to make the stranger feel welcome.
You can tell him for me. I think he's simply a doll. And I couldn't be crazy about these old Eastern customs.
Cast as a character whose logic was as fuzzy as her eyesight, Marilyn once again played the dumb blonde.
All my life, ever since I was a little girl, I've always had the same dream, to marry a zillionaire.
Do you know who I'd like to marry?
Who?
Rockefeller.
Which one?
I don't care.
The film was a glittering, star-studded romp, and Monroe's comic way with a line added immeasurably to the film's success.
Look.
Yes?
Didn't you bring your glasses?
What glasses?
Don't you wear glasses?
Oh, dear me, no. Whatever gives you that idea?
You've got the most peculiar vision I ever saw.
Why do you say that?
Because you're reading that book upside down.
But I'm no such thing.
Not you, the book.
But by now, it was becoming apparent that Monroe's own success was largely dependent on her rather limited screen persona.
He sounds just wonderful. I was naturally curious to know what he looked like.
Who is he?
I don't know that either, but he hasn't mentioned anything under $1 million yet.
Worse was the public tendency to confuse Marilyn the person with the rather two-dimensional characters that she was given to play on the screen. Unfortunately, it was a confusion Marilyn did nothing to dismiss.
They thought of her as a joke. And they made the worst, worst jokes about her. When we'd be on the lot and she'd walk down the street, they would run out and walk behind her and imitate her walk. And then, you know, if she turned or something, everybody would stop, you know. I mean, she was like the butt of everybody's jokes.
Although Marilyn privately pleaded with Fox for more dramatic roles, the studio was unresponsive. Compounding his lack of faith in Monroe's acting ability was Zanuck's unwillingness to tamper with Marilyn's successful screen formula.
She wanted to be taken more seriously because she was taking the work seriously. She got recognition as a glamour girl, but now she wanted to go on and be something more solid.
Zanuck refused to give in, and next teamed Monroe with Robert Mitchum in the rugged frontier thriller River of No Return.
Hey, what's going on here?
Are you crazy, Matt? Put me down. Matt! Where are you taking me?
Home.
Directed by Otto Preminger, the film was an uneasy mix of widescreen grandeur and Wild West cliches. Preminger's gruff directing style and Monroe's sensitive temperament did not mesh well. At times, Marilyn looked awkward and out of place.
I'd be alive again if I hadn't starved to death. I see you're still alive.
How's the water?
Freezing, but I'm becoming hardened. I guess it's from seeing life in the raw and running around with strong, silent types like you guys.
Monroe was frequently late to the set and was often uncooperative. What was at first viewed as insecurity was becoming branded as unprofessionalism. In a bold rebuff to the studio, Marilyn refused to accept her next assignment in the lightweight comedy The Girl in Pink Tights. Sending Zanuck a terse telegram, she informed him of her disapproval of the script and story. She was immediately placed on suspension without pay. As a further threat, actress Sherry North was made up to look like Monroe and was cast in her place.
When I did my screen test at Fox, they put me in all of Marilyn's clothes and I did all the numbers from The Girl in Pink Tights. I don't think they were molding me as much as they dressed me up in all of her clothes and got all the press in and said, here's the replacement, because they were trying to threaten Marilyn to coming back and doing as they wished. So they were using me in that sense to try to make her get in line and do what they wanted.
With her career temporarily on hold, Marilyn accepted longtime boyfriend Joe DiMaggio's proposal of marriage. Originally intended as a small civil ceremony, the wedding, held at San Francisco's City Hall on January 14, 1954, was anything but private. Hollywood's reigning sex goddess and baseball's legendary superstar were now man and wife. As if declaring her independence from Skank, Zanuck, and Fox, Marilyn had taken charge of her life. It would be the first in a series of dramatic moves that would change her life forever. As if humbled by the intense public support of her marriage, Zanuck decided to lift Marilyn's suspension. The news came as something of a wedding gift as the couple took a romantic trip to the Far East.
Followed by a crowd of admirers, the nation's most famous newlyweds, Marilyn Monroe and Joe DiMaggio, the popular film star and famous home run hitter, are off for Japan.
Here in post-war Japan, baseball had become a national obsession. But when the famous Yankee Clipper arrived with Hollywood's blonde bombshell, it didn't take long to realize that Marilyn was the superstar in the family. And when she interrupted her honeymoon to entertain war-weary GIs in Korea, Marilyn came face to face with her adoring public and realized for the first time the enormity of her fame.
She's in Korea and hundreds of thousands of men are applauding and cheering, and it was probably her first major dose of what it was like to be Marilyn Monroe in front of the public.
Performing 10 shows in 2 days to adoring crowds of over 100,000 soldiers, Marilyn was exhilarated. But husband Joe was not used to playing second fiddle to his celebrity wife, and tensions grew. Returning to Hollywood, Marilyn exerted her newfound confidence by refusing a leading role in Irving Berlin's There's No Business Like Show Business until her salary was up to an impressive $3,000 a week.
When you bring him back to see me, I want to show him that I'm an actress, too.
Teamed with Ethel Merman, Dan Daly, Mitzi Gaynor, and Donald O'Connor, the film was a conventional backstage confection, with Marilyn stealing every scene as an amorous showgirl.
Well, anyway, I guess Lou thinks I'm ready now. He's planning to build a whole new review around me next season on Broadway.
Yeah. I'd like to build something around you. Barbed wire fence.
Having a heat wave. Tropical, tropical heat wave. The way that I move, that thermometer proves.
She certainly can.
I certainly can.
Standing in sharp contrast to her screen success, however, were the growing conflicts in Monroe's high-profile marriage to Joe DiMaggio.
He loved Joe very much, but he had absolutely no use for show business. He hated show business. If Marilyn had to come to an industry function, like, say, the Photoplay Awards or something like that, he'd wait outside in the lobby of the Beverly Hills Hotel. She'd have to go in alone.
Are you sure you want to waste your champagne now that you know that I'm married?
I think it's wonderful that you're married. I think it's just delicate.
You do?
Of course. I mean, I wouldn't be lying on the floor in the middle of the night in some man's apartment drinking champagne if he wasn't married.
Based on a successful Broadway comedy, Billy Wilder's production of The 7-Year Itch solidified Marilyn's status as America's leading sex object.
Let me just go put something on. I'll go into the kitchen and get dressed.
The kitchen?
Yes, when it's hot like this, you know what I do? I keep my undies in the icebox.
In the icebox?
See you in a minute.
Co-starring Tom Ewell, the story concerned a middle-aged husband's hilarious efforts to seduce his very desirable upstairs neighbor.
Because now I'm going to take you in my arms and kiss you very quickly. And very hard.
Wait a minute! What happened? I kind of lost track.
I don't know. Well, this is terrible. There's nothing I can say except that I'm terribly sorry. Nothing like this ever happened to me before in all my life.
Honest? Happens to me all the time.
As the neighbor with no name, Marilyn was willingly playing into the notion that her on-screen persona and off-screen personality were one and the same. The line between reality and fantasy was being blurred forever, a line that Joe DiMaggio was desperate to maintain.
I can explain everything, the stairs, the cinnamon toast, the blonde in the kitchen.
Now, wait a minute, Dickie boy, let's just take it easy. What blonde in the kitchen?
Wouldn't you like to know? Maybe it's Marilyn Monroe.
Marilyn is in New York. She's going to film what's called the skirt scene for The 7-Year Itch.
Didn't you just love the picture? I did.
But I just felt so sorry for the creature at the end.
Sorry for the creature? Why'd you want him to marry the girl?
He was kind of scary looking, but he wasn't really all bad. I think he just craved a little affection, you know, a sense of being loved and needed and wanted.
She understood her skirt would be blowing up, and she noticed in the mirror that you could see through the panties. So she requested and put on a second pair of panties, two pair of panties. And in the dressing room, it covered the problem. But outside on the street with 5,000 onlookers, under the Klieg lights, it didn't cover the problem.
That's a very interesting point of view.
Oh, do you feel the breeze from the subway? Isn't it delicious?
Sort of cools the ankles, doesn't it?
Joe and his buddy Walter Winchell were nearby.
For New Yorkers watching the endless retakes, this was the greatest show on earth. But for DiMaggio, the leering crowds offered a public humiliation.
Joe was horrified because his wife's dress was blowing over her knees, indeed blowing higher than her waist.
Her body had always provided the key to her success. For Monroe, the public display was a celebration of her sexual and her professional power. But for Joe, Marilyn's exhibitionism could no longer be confused with her professional responsibility. His embarrassment and jealousy quickly gave way to anger.
I think that marriage was dead the day they married. And there are issues that occurred in that household that have never been made public. And I think in the end, it wasn't really Marilyn or Joe who made that decision. I think the big boys at Fox walked into that house and said, "You're out of here," because they had to protect their property.
On October 28, 1954, Marilyn Monroe filed for divorce in Santa Monica, California.
Miss Monroe will have nothing to say this morning. All I can say as her attorney is that this is what we would say with the conflict of careers.
Okay, Jerry.
I'm sorry, I have to go. I'm sorry.
What the press had dubbed the marriage of the decade had ended in less than a year. Following her divorce from Joe DiMaggio, Marilyn Monroe continued to leverage her enormous popularity in order to further her screen career. At the age of 28, she took the advice of photographer Milton Green and formed her own company, Marilyn Monroe Productions. Furious at his star's repeated attempts to assert her independence, Fox chief Daryl Zanuck reminded her that she still had 3 years left on her studio contract. It was a classic Hollywood confrontation, and one in which Zanuck had the upper hand. After turning down another role as a blonde stereotype in How to Be Very, Very Popular, she was again suspended on January 15, 1955. Leaving her lawyers to deal with the studio, she left for Manhattan, the home of the American theater, there to pursue her dream of becoming a serious actress.
So she was invited to join the Actors Studio as an observer, and for almost a year, she didn't do anything but observe.
It was a group very conscious of the fact that they had a famous movie star sitting in the corner watching. She wasn't allowed to participate.
So she soaked up the atmosphere of the studio. It was like, the studio was like a gymnasium where an actor could work out. And if he had a specific problem or she had a problem, the teachers would work on that problem. They'd pick a scene from a play, do it, and then get criticized. So it was like a doctor giving a diagnosis of what's the matter with you. And that captivated her.
Under the direction of Lee and Paula Strasberg, the Actors Studio had started something of a revolution. Its teachings incorporated many bold and innovative techniques.
Basically, what it was an attempt to train the actor to get to the point that inspiration occurs at. So that was relaxation, concentration, imagination.
Well, when you go for the kind of acting that Marilyn went for, which we would call the method, you do an inordinate amount of internal examination, which is very frightening.
Can you imagine, as a movie star in 1955, to come into an acting class of unknowns, people who'd never worked, and put yourself out there on the line at the same level, not asking for special treatment? I don't know many people who would do that. But she was that hungry to learn.
While at the actor's studio, Marilyn became more than a student to Lee and Paula Strasberg. She also became a live-in member of their family.
When Marilyn first came east, almost immediately, she became a part of the family. And Marilyn, as a pretty young girl, had already been beaten up emotionally, physically, in a town that uses people like disposable Kleenexes. And she was jealous of me, too. It was like sibling rivalry, which is strange, you know, to be rivals with a 28-year-old woman who was this enormous star. We were sharing a room on Fire Island, where we had a summer house, and I woke up early in the morning, and Marilyn was standing nude, watching the sun come up. And I was looking at her and going, oh. And she caught me watching her, and I was a little embarrassed, and I said, you know, Marilyn, I'd give anything to be like you. She was horrified, and she said, oh, Susie, don't say that. I'd give anything to be like you. People respect you. So I think that what she wanted and what she got from my father was respect.
After class, sometimes we'd go out and have coffee and talk and so on. We were sitting one time at a coffee place, and they were putting up a huge picture of her from the 7-year itch. You know, where she stands over the subway grating, and she looked up, and her skirt is flying in the air, and she said, you see, that's all they think of me. That's what they think of me. But someday I want to play Grushinka in The Brothers Karamazov.
When it premiered on Marilyn's 29th birthday on June 1st, 1955, The 7-Year Itch became a critical and box office smash. But the film's success only served to strengthen Marilyn's inner conflict, her twin desires to be a serious actress and a popular star.
When Marilyn walked out on her contract and went to New York, the powers that be at 20th Century Fox realized that an important source of corporate income was lost to them. So although they started to file suit and caused a big brouhaha and put out stories of an uncooperative star, the fact is they desperately needed her.
Marilyn still needed 20th Century Fox, and 20th Century Fox still needed her. Forced to reconsider his position, Zanuck prepared a new contract. This time, Marilyn would have script and director approval.
Is it true that you submitted a list of directors that you would work with? We only know the rumors we hear, you know.
I would rather say that I have director approval, and that is true.
This you think is important?
Yes, it is. Very important to me.
It was very unusual but very wise of 20th Century Fox to allow Marilyn directorial approval. They knew that she needed to feel very confident in her respect and in the guidance that she wanted from her directors. So there was a short list. And on that list were the names of Joseph Mankiewicz and John Huston and William Wyler and Alfred Hitchcock.
While she was in New York, Marilyn began socializing with playwright Arthur Miller, the author of one of modern American theater's most compelling works, Death of a Salesman. Contrary to her screen image, Marilyn enjoyed the company of bohemians and intellectuals, and soon her friendship with Miller blossomed into a serious romance.
A serious, successful playwright, an older man, an intellectual, had all the qualities that she idolized most in men.
I think Arthur and Marilyn we're in love with one another. But again, you don't know what they knew of each other that they were in love with.
Professionally confident, if still emotionally insecure, Marilyn Monroe returned to Hollywood. She had accepted the lead in a film version of William Inge's Broadway hit, Bus Stop. It was the kind of challenging and complex role she craved, but it was also the kind of role that would expose some of her worst fears.
see by this just how straight my direction is. River Gulch is where I started. This is where I am now. And look where I'm going.
Where?
Hollywood and Vine. Look, straight as an arrow. River Gulch. Hollywood and Vine.
What happens when you get there?
What happens, honey? You get discovered, you get tested with options and everything. And you get treated with a little respect, too.
Directed by Josh Logan, Bus Stop offered Marilyn Monroe her most challenging role to date.
Bus Stop was her comeback film after leaving movies for a year to study at the Actors Studio. And when she came back, everybody wanted an interview, everybody wanted a picture. I don't think any of us who came from the theater, came from the stage, thought that her performance was going to be very good.
As Cherie, the roadhouse torch singer whose dreams of stardom are shattered by harsh realities, Marilyn felt she had much to prove. Bus Stop was her first film since returning from New York, and she felt a responsibility to validate her controversial training at the Actors Studio.
That old black magic has me in its spell.
I think she could relate to that character very strongly and knew that character very well. She went for broke in it, and I think she did probably some of her strongest acting in that film.
I just can't lie to you, and I can't marry you, and I ain't going to Montana with you. And goodbye forever.
Cherie, wait a sec. Cherie, wait. Cherie!
She was using her own real emotions for the first time. I think that's what made the big markation between her as a very, very good musical comedy performer and an interesting personality and a real actress, because she was using her own inner life.
Jerry, it wasn't right of me to do what I did to you, treating you that way, dragging you on the bus, and trying to make you marry me whether you wanted to or not. Do you think you can ever forgive me?
I guess I've been treated worse in my life.
But under the harsh glare of the studio lights, Marilyn's deep-seated insecurities were beginning to take their toll. Often late to the set, she became more and more dependent on pills to calm her down.
Marilyn's like, I guess you'd call her the major movie star of the world at that time, and I expected someone much more sure of themselves. But she wasn't like that at all. She was very insecure, very vulnerable. And I think she relied very heavily on her coach, Paula Strasberg.
Paula Strasberg had accompanied Marilyn to Los Angeles as her personal drama coach. Strasberg's emphasis on inner examination encouraged the actress to confront her feelings of loneliness and abandonment, and also forced her to examine the sexual nature of her screen appeal.
I hear your name, and I'm aflame. That only your kiss can put out the fire.
She was wonderful in the part, but she had a very short concentration span. So you'd start a scene with her, and you could have a speech, 10 lines long, and she'd have to say, what, at the end of it, and three-quarters of the time, she'd forget to say, what, and you'd have to do it all over again. And the magic of movies, the way they can take something and cut it together, as long as the work is honest and real, and the way they can cut it together and make a whole of it, make a performance out of it, was extraordinary.
I still wish you was going back to the ranch with me more than anything I knew.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
Well, I'd go anywhere in the world with you now. Anywhere at all.
In the end, Marilyn's performance garnered tremendous acclaim, showing a perception and depth of character which quieted many of her harshest critics. Newly validated, Marilyn began to consider a third try at marriage when playwright Arthur Miller proposed.
I remember one time she asked me, "Do you think a leopard could change its spots?" And I said, "What?" And after I talked for a while, I realized what she was talking about. What she was saying to me is, "Do you think somebody with my background could ever become the kind of a person that Arthur Miller would find happiness with?"
"When are you going to be married?"
"I don't know right now. I haven't had a minute to think, but it'll be shortly."
"I think it's time enough for everybody to know when it happens and leave us with a little bit of peace until it happens."
"When are you planning to have some children?"
"Well, I'm not married yet, dear."
On July 1st, 1956, after a private wedding ceremony at Arthur Miller's parents' home, the newlyweds traveled to England, where Marilyn was to star opposite Laurence Olivier in the lighthearted romance, The Prince and the Showgirl.
"You know what's going to happen? I'm going to fall in love with you. Because I always, always do."
"Always?"
"Both times."
But all was not well on the set of what was to be Monroe's first independent production. Considered by many people to be the finest actor of his generation, Laurence Olivier had no patience with the indulgences associated with Marilyn's method acting. He found her chronic tardiness and her dependency on Paula Strasberg to be glaring examples of a pampered star's unprofessionalism.
"She had the guts to hire Laurence Olivier, who had no respect for her. I think Olivier had contempt for Marilyn. I think he resented the fact that she was paying his bills."
Despite positive press and royal reviews, The Prince and the Showgirl was a slow-moving miscalculation, and the glaring lack of chemistry between the two principals did not help matters.
"Terrible! You made a pass and I turned it down."
Returning to the United States, Marilyn found her playwright husband the target of anti-communist witch hunters.
That Mr. Miller was brought up on these absurd charges of being a traitor to the country or communist associations and all this rubbish that swept the country in the 1950s. Marilyn stood by him because she believed that these were trumped up charges leveled against a serious artist.
"I would like to say that I'm fully confident that in the end my husband will win this case."
"And it didn't upset your professional career at all? It didn't stop anything you were working on at the time?"
No, I haven't been working recently."
"And what are your plans when you return to New York?"
"Well, we hope to go back to our normal life."
On August 1st, 1957, Marilyn's emotional balance toppled. She suffered a miscarriage and became convinced that years of sexual indiscretion had left her unable to have children. She became haunted by her mother's insanity and continued to slip farther and farther into depressions that were hard to control. In need of a distraction, she found one in the form of a comedy directed by Billy Wilder.
"Not since Scarface, so much action. Not since the Marx Brothers, so much comedy. Not since the 7-year itch, so much Marilyn. The best picture this year will also be the funniest.
Good night, sugar.
Good night, honey."
Some Like It Hot, which Marilyn originally did not want to do, had to be done for one very simple reason. The Millers needed money. In addition to that, not all of her co-stars found her easy to work with.
Tony Curtis once said that kissing Marilyn was like kissing Hitler.
"You're not giving yourself a chance. Don't fight it. Relax."
Constantly late and unfamiliar with the script, Marilyn had to have her dialogue written on cue cards and placed around the set.
"Just before she would do something, she'd shake her hands and relax and she'd have Paula right there, and Paula was watching everything, that she did it right.
I mean, my mother literally sat with her. It was like 24 hours on those films, holding her hand, trying to get her to take less pills. The incredible insecurity that she had, so that she needed to be pampered and reassured. My mother gave her life's blood in a way and got blamed on top of it for Marilyn's unprofessional behavior.
Also distracting were problems with the actress's fluctuating weight and chronic fatigue.
When you're working, particularly if you're on location, you can't sleep. They have a guy who's probably a registered nurse at best, but they're called doctor, and you always call them doc. And if you're not sleeping, the doctor says, here, take these. This will help you. So you take them and you sleep, thank God, so you can get up and work. Because, you know, you're up all night thinking about this, that, you know, how do I read the line and all that stuff. So they get you hooked on the sleeping pills. Then doc says in the morning, well, how do you feel? Well, okay, I feel groggy. Here, take this. And they hand you some Benzedrine. And so you take that so you're awake all day. And so that's how it happens. But way back then, we didn't, the word side effects didn't exist. If a doctor gave you a pill, it was good for you. That's what we thought. And Marilyn got hooked like everybody else did. Nobody knew.
But what was not generally known was that Marilyn had become pregnant again, and after the filming would suffer yet another miscarriage. Despite the difficulties in making the film, Some Like It Hot would become Marilyn's biggest hit to date. To the studio, Marilyn Monroe was still a steady source of income. To the public, she was still a star. But like all stars, she was beginning to burn out.
While tearing off a game of golf, I may make a play for the caddy. But when I do, I don't follow through, 'cause my heart belongs to Daddy.
Monroe's follow-up to the box office smash Some Like It Hot would be the offbeat romantic comedy Let's Make Love.
You're really French, aren't you?
Yes. Very much so.
Well, that my heart belongs to my daddy, 'cause daddy, my daddy, my little old daddy, he treats it so. That little old man, he just treats it so good.
By 1960, the sharp contrast between Monroe's sexy screen image and the torment of her private life was evident. She was beginning to look heavy and older than her 33 years. Her self-destructive behavior led to frequent absences, and at times, she seemed strangely disconnected from her fellow actors.
Look what happened the moment you knew who I was. Even you were impressed. Admit it. You no longer saw me, you saw only power.
Ray, I've never been so humiliated in my life. The least you could have done is tell me who you are.
I did tell you.
How did you expect me to believe it?
Because it's what's true.
That's no excuse.
Rumors of a highly charged off-screen affair with co-star Yves Montand began to circulate.
Marilyn Monroe, aided by director George Cukor on Wright, throws a Hollywood studio press party to introduce the male stars of her new film comedy, Let's Make Love. And second from left is Frankie Vaughan, England's most popular singer.
Now, for press records, Marvelous Marilyn poses with another of her male luminaries, Yves Montand.
Like her delicate mental state, her marriage to playwright Arthur Miller was breaking apart.
I never know when a relationship begins to go to pot. But while we were making The Misfits, the open warfare was declared, and it was very difficult for her.
These giants of the entertainment world have combined their talents to create an outstanding motion picture.
I don't feel that way about you, Kay.
Well, don't get discouraged, girl. You might.
The Misfits. Starring the screen's most exciting woman, Marilyn Monroe.
Written by Arthur Miller as a vehicle for his wife, The Misfits was a somber tale of modern-day cowboys struggling to find an identity. Shot in Reno, Nevada, and directed by John Huston, the film teamed Marilyn with a dream cast that included Clark Gable, Montgomery Clift, and Eli Wallach.
Each male in that movie wanted to help this lady, and that's the point of that film. Arthur had written a kind of Valentine to Marilyn.
You belong to Gay?
I don't know where I belong.
The dark tone of the story seemed to mirror the atmosphere on the set. Costly delays and unprofessional behavior sent tempers over the boiling point. Marilyn continued to rely on prescription drugs to get her through the day, a situation similar to that of co-star Montgomery Clift. Worse was the frail actress's now legendary tardiness and her almost pathological dependency on Paula Strasberg, which caused Gable to complain that her behavior was certain to give him a heart attack.
I was on this set the last day of shooting, and Marilyn again was 7 or 8 hours late. And Gable says, "What the hell's wrong with this girl?"
Sadly, just 3 weeks after shooting was completed, Clark Gable, Marilyn's childhood hero, did die of a heart attack.
Marilyn felt a great deal of guilt about Gable because all the waiting around, he got impatient and started doing his own stunts. He was roping those horses on that picture, and that probably led to a stress. Marilyn called Kay Gable up and expressed her sorrow and her guilt, because she figured that maybe her unprofessionalism had caused his death. And Kay says, no. She says, Clark never complained.
The Misfits proved to be the last act for Marilyn and her playwright husband. After returning to New York, the two divorced, and despite good notices, the film failed at the box office. With her personal life and her career falling apart, Marilyn had nothing left to hold on to. She began sinking deeper and deeper into a downward spiral of depression and substance abuse.
And she, in fact, went into a terrific nervous anxiety, and her New York psychiatrist at the time had her institutionalized. And this threw Marilyn into almost a psychotic panic.
Entering the Payne Whitney Psychiatric Clinic in New York for treatment in 1961, Marilyn's worst fear was coming true. She was suffering the same fate as her mother.
The fact of the matter is that when Marilyn was ill at this period of time in New York, her great friend, her great comfort, the one to whom she could turn, was Joe DiMaggio. And he looked after her, and he took her from the hospital.
Just when she needed him the most, Joe DiMaggio re-entered Marilyn's life to help her through the emotional crisis. But as she recovered, it became clear that her old self-destructive patterns were re-emerging. Still craving the attention and the validation of powerful men, she began socializing with Frank Sinatra and the members of his famous Rat Pack. She also began an intense and highly secret relationship with President John F. Kennedy, to whom she had been introduced by actor and Kennedy brother-in-law Peter Lawford. Convinced that she was well enough to work, she returned to Fox for a remake of an old Cary Grant Irene Dunn comedy called My Favorite Wife. Now retitled Something's Gotta Give, the story concerned a woman's struggle to reacquaint herself with her family 5 years after being lost at sea. It was the kind of picture Marilyn had proved she could do better than anyone. As she posed for these hair and makeup tests, she looked trim, happy, and ready to work. Unfortunately, Marilyn's new look was only an illusion.
Come on! The water's so refreshing!
In a highly controversial and highly publicized move, Marilyn agreed to perform her first on-camera nude scene. Proud of the fact that she had shed 15 pounds for the production, she frolicked boldly for the cameras. Not since her infamous calendar photos had Monroe so shrewdly used nudity to gain attention and notoriety. Though occasionally submitting to the confines of a flesh-colored G-string, she giggled and teased coyly as if to celebrate her reclaimed status as Hollywood's reigning sex symbol. But Marilyn's desperate attempts at happiness would prove futile. Under the paternal gaze of George Cukor, the man who had directed her in Let's Make Love, Marilyn frequently forgot her lines and appeared nervous and high-strung.
All right, come.
Adam and Eve.
I was afraid you'd misunderstand about that.
Oh, what's to misunderstand? A man's wife spends 5 years on an island with a strange man?
Would you like it any better if I knew him?
And it slips her mind?
Can we start again?
Yeah. And it slips her mind.
First of all,
he brushes his leg getting in the canoe.
In the first place, you don't understand. You see, he was trying to get the boat to the surf. He broke his leg. He was laid up for 6 months.
6 months? That still leaves 4.5 years.
All you can think about is the way I behaved with this poor little,
with this poor little fly.
As filming continued, it became apparent to her co-stars that Marilyn was distracted and had trouble focusing. During the first weeks of shooting, she hardly appeared on the set. And often, director Cukor was forced to shoot around her, going so far as to read Marilyn's lines to Dean Martin from off camera.
Put this on.
When you're all finished, come on in. It's very refreshing.
Making the production particularly difficult for Monroe were these scenes in which he had to perform with children.
It was hard because had her children lived, they would have been the same age as the children she worked with. The children loved her. She played with them. But it was sad. Marilyn wanted children. In fact, before the picture started, she went to Mexico and she went to these orphanages looking for a little child. She wanted them badly.
Come here.
What?
I want to hug you.
Me too!
You too, both of you. You know what you two kids are.
What?
You're my two sweethearts. My two best sweethearts in the whole world. Hey, you little rascals.
Cut it, go on.
On May 19th, 1962, Marilyn abruptly left the set of Something's Gotta Give and boarded a plane to New York. She was determined to get there in time to perform at John F. Kennedy's birthday party.
It's an honor to go to the president's ball. She wasn't the only one that was invited. There were many, and she had permission.
It was a very long evening, and during the course of the evening, Peter Lawford introduced Marilyn perhaps 4 or 5 times. and it was a setup kind of situation.
Mr. President, on this occasion of your birthday, this lovely lady is not only punctitudinous, but punctual. Mr. President, Marilyn Monroe.
And then he would point to that area of the stage where she was to enter, and she wouldn't enter.
A woman about whom it truly may be said she needs no introduction. But let me just say, here she is.
And something like 4 to 5 hours into the program, it was an extraordinarily long evening, he introduced her as the birthday cake was being wheeled out in the back. And of course, this is the way it was all designed. And she appeared on the stage, incredibly beautiful.
Mr. President, the late Marilyn Monroe.
She was terrified, wouldn't you be? What was it? I don't know how many, 50,000 people, whatever it was. And not feeling well. To get up there, she drank a lot of champagne. So now she was tight. Well, I guess maybe people loved it, but for me it was a caricature.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mr. President. Happy birthday to you.
Once again, Marilyn made headlines and ruffled feathers. But when she returned to Hollywood and back to the set for her own birthday, the producers were in no mood to celebrate.
We had this cake decorated, and the day of her birthday, I picked up the cake, and they were screaming at me that I had to hide the cake because it wasn't going to be brought out until 6 o'clock. They had to get a full day's work out of that woman. That was the expression. That was the last day she worked.
20th Century Fox had had enough of Marilyn's antics.
Wait a minute. Sorry.
In 30 shooting days, she had only shown up for work 13 times. What little footage had been shot had proved to be a hopeless jumble.
Oh, damn it. We're getting there.
Fox executives shut the picture down. Marilyn Monroe was fired, and the footage, unedited, would be consigned to the studio's vaults. Now living alone and only 36 years old, Marilyn tried to remain brave in the face of her humiliating ordeal. But once again, she resorted to pills. In the weeks that followed her dismissal from Something's Gotta Give and her banishment from the studio that had been her home for 15 years, Marilyn made frequent and frantic calls to friends, lovers, and anyone who would listen. For a while, it seemed as if she would pull through. She was still young, still attractive, still Marilyn. But on August 5th, 1962, Marilyn's housekeeper, Eunice Murray, found the once glamorous superstar dead. She was face down in her bed, pills at her side, and a telephone in her hand, the victim of an accidental suicide.
I was the first one out to her house, and I was there when they wheeled her body out, put it in the little station wagon, coroner station wagon, and she had a little cotton blanket around her, covering her head. It was so sad, you know, to see that beautiful creature being wheeled out like that in a cheap cotton blanket. Yeah, very, very sad.
Miss Monroe has suffered from psychiatric disturbance for a long time. She had often expressed wishes to give up, to withdraw, and even to die. On more than one occasion in the past, when disappointed and depressed, she had made a suicide attempt using sedative drugs. On these occasions, she had called for help and had been rescued. From the information collected about the events of the evening of August the 4th, it is our opinion that the same pattern was repeated except for the rescue. On the basis of all the information obtained, it is our opinion that the case is a probable suicide.
Almost instantly, the lurid circumstances of Marilyn's death made national headlines across the world. And just as quickly came rumors of foul play, perhaps involving the Kennedys or the mob. Marilyn Monroe was dead. Marilyn the myth was born. As if to prevent Hollywood from exploiting her yet again, Joe DiMaggio barred all but Marilyn's closest friends and relatives from the funeral, held at Westwood Cemetery in Los Angeles. It was even rumored that DiMaggio, still in love with Marilyn, had made plans to remarry his ex-wife.
And for years after Marilyn's death, Joe adorned Marilyn's memorial spot with flowers. He has refused to make book or make money by talking. He has turned down offers of enormous amounts of cash to write his story. He never married again. He adored her in life and has been respectful and honorable toward her memory in death.
In death as in life, Marilyn Monroe had retained her superstar status. The aging sex symbol was now an ageless deity. Her platinum hair had become a halo, her sensual face an icon. For Norma Jean Baker, the orphaned girl with dreams of stardom, life was a tortured path of broken promises and bitter realities. But for Marilyn Monroe, the incandescent star whose image blazed across the silver screen, dreams became reality. Hers is the kind of immortality reserved for very few. And it's her tragic vulnerability, her childlike innocence, that will stand the test of time.
She's a mythic figure in the culture, a kind of kaleidoscope in which we see ourselves. So I think actually we can learn a lot about ourselves by understanding our feelings toward Marilyn.
She had a little glowing essence there. And in spite of everything that had been done, or everything she had done, and everything that had been done to her, it still glowed.
I think Marilyn projected all the desirability that a man would want in a woman. But there was a soul there. I can see her soul and her vulnerability, as well as her deep desire to be wanted and loved, and her wit and her humor and her intelligence.
I miss her. I really do. And people are losers because she left us.
Once upon a time, there was a fairy princess called Marilyn Monroe. Norma Jean was the real person. I just hope people realize that she was a real person.
I knew I belonged to the public and to the world, she once admitted, not because I was talented or even beautiful, but because I had never belonged to anything or anyone else.
An angel in lace, a fabulous face.
That's no exaggeration, that's my Marilyn.
No gal, I believe, beginning with E,
could weave a fascination like my Marilyn. She made me a poet, dreaming of romantic things.
Though she may not know it,
she's all mine in my dreams.
He planned everything, the church and the ring.
The one I haven't told it to is Marilyn.
She hasn't said yes.
I have to confess, I haven't kissed or even met my Marilyn. But if luck is with me,
she'll be my bride forevermore.
I'll be marrying, carrying Marilyn through my door. Chuck is with me. She'll be my bride